Welcome, everybody. I think everyone here is familiar faces again, and hopefully we'll see more new folks coming in as this COVID stuff gets out of the world at some point. But welcome, glad you're here at Northside this morning. I see smiles. That's a good thing. I think all you guys know me by now, so I'm Aaron Yates. And I am on week number two and a half, I think, as your pastor. So it's good to see everybody. We've already had a good morning this morning. I know everyone. No, I don't. Do not. I don't even remember. I can't tell you my kids' names right now. So that's a challenge for me. I don't know how the former pastors were at remembering names, but yeah, that's a challenge for me. So a couple of announcements to mention. We're glad you're here, and later on we'll do a virtual handshake. Randy's good at that. A couple of announcements. We're going through on Wednesday nights a study called The Person of Jesus, and just for a few weeks, I don't know how long we'll stay there for sure, but we'd love to see you there on Wednesday nights. We're spread out pretty good on Wednesday nights, and we're looking at how Jesus dealt with people, and kind of putting yourself in the crowd with him. So I'm excited about this study and being there for the next couple weeks. So we welcome you to join us. We had a good time this Wednesday. And next Sunday, we will be going through, as I wrap up the gospel, kind of in part three, we want to look at grace versus the law. And it's pretty neat how all this is tying in with what's going on in Sunday school too, talking about the law. So hope to see you again next week. Glad you're here this week. But I hope to see you again in the week to come. We'll have put some dates on the calendar, and I'm going to be working on some things on the technical side, figuring out how we can connect with people well and make sure everybody, those that are watching via video, are connected with what's going on here. And we're going to be working on some of those communication side of things at Northside via Facebook, via newsletter, just figuring out how to let people know what's going on if they want to be here. Hopefully you'll see some news on that in the weeks ahead, and just watch for that, and we'll let you know about things like we have Lord's Supper coming up soon, some of those things on the calendar. We're looking at a possible outdoor connection event in the weeks ahead too. So trying to do some things, still figure out how we do things in the midst of what's going on with Corona, but God is good, and we'll continue to press on. All right? Is there anything I am missing this morning? Announcement-wise, anything like that? Speak now or forever hold your peace. We good? All right, well, let's pray together. God, we are so grateful for our time together this morning as we come to worship you. And help us to, from the inside out, know the purpose, the reason, the need for that. To set ourselves aside that we might pursue you and know you more. God, that is the fullness of life, the fullness of joy. May our delight be in you and you alone, that we might have the capacity to love others better, to love others well. Father, I pray that we would have hearts of repentance this morning. Knowing that you love us, that we can rest in you, that we can conquer things we don't think are, that we are able to, through the power of your Holy Spirit. God, give us eyes to see a world that needs you, and to recognize where we can be the hands and feet and feet of Jesus to those people. And God, I just pray for a work at Northside. I pray in this strange time that's going on in our world, that you would still give us wisdom on how to love people well, maybe in a way we haven't before, how to see them as you see them, and how to serve them as you would have us serve them as a church, as individuals, and in every area of our life. God, we just thank you once again for being good. I pray you are recognized this morning as our true King, and that we would crown you King in our lives and as a church this morning. We pray it in your holy name. Amen.
Let's stand together, worship together, the heart of worship when the music fades. When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, when it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior art thou. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I love thee because thou hast first loved me and purchased my pardon on Calvary's tree. I love thee for wearing the thorns on thy brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I love thee in life, I will love thee in death, and praise thee as long as thou lendest me breath. And say when the death dew lies cold on my brow, if ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. In mansions of glory, in endless delight, I'll ever adore thee in heaven so bright. And I'll sing with the glittering crown on my brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. Lord Jesus, we love you. God, we love you, and we thank you for all that you do for us, Lord. We thank you that for who you are in our lives, Lord. And we just thank you that we can let the world know that you love them and want a relationship with them, Lord. We just pray that as we uplift the name of Jesus, draw us closer to you. Forgive us where we failed you, Lord. And we do it daily. And we're just thankful for your forgiveness. Lead and guide and direct us in all that we do. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a seat. That's right.
I want to ask Raymond the Simmons to come up. Raymond's worked a lot over the past year at church. And I'm here, one of the leaders
in my coming here. So let's give Randy a hand. Just thank him for the work he does. So.
To come up and join me up here.
Do I get to preach?
No, sorry. Not this time.
It's not worth the trip then.
Pastor Ken, for the past year, you have been our pastor, and we all know that there's much more to being a pastor than just preaching up here on Sunday morning. It requires your dedication and your leadership, and we want to just thank you. I personally want to thank you, and I know the whole transition team echoes that, for your advice and counsel during the 15 months that we went through searching for the next steps for Northside and seeking God's will in that. And so on behalf of the entire church, it's hard to do this with a mic in my hand. But we wanted to just give you this gift as just a small token of our appreciation for all that you've done for this church and for each and every one of us. So that's for you. Thank you. God bless you.
Thank you.
They have children here. Is this when they usually do it?
Yeah.
You want to go ahead and do the greeting thing, and then I'll
do it afterwards.
Okay, we'll do. Okay, I think we have some kids here, so we're going to rally them up, if they can hear me. So, y'all want to go ahead and give a wave, handshake?
I can do that.
Look around. If you're on video watching us, welcome. I got to be conscious of that. I step out of frame a lot. So I'm sorry if I disappear on the video for those of you that are watching via video. Here we go. They sit on the steps? All right. I know mine likes being front and center. I'm not sure. Y'all want to sit here? All right, I'm going to try to sit by you. Hey, Lydia, what's your name?
Peyton.
All right, good deal. I've got a book. This is one of my favorite books. And I want you to listen to this too. This is a book called the Jesus Storybook Bible. And sometimes we'll look at some stuff in the mornings and objects and talk about objects. But this is a great little introduction to this book about Jesus. I want you to hear this, okay? And it should relate to what you're doing in Sunday school this morning. The story and the song. God wrote, I love you. He wrote it in the sky and on the earth and under the sea. He wrote his message everywhere. because God created everything in his world to reflect him like a mirror, to show us what he is like and to help us know him, to make our hearts sing. The way the kitten chases her tail, the way the red poppies grow wild, and the way a dolphin swims. God put into words, too, and wrote it in a book called the Bible. Now, some people think the Bible is a book of rules telling you what you should and shouldn't do. The Bible certainly does have some rules in it to show you how life works best, but the Bible isn't mainly about you and what you should be doing. It's about God and what he has done. Other people think the Bible is a book of heroes. You see these pictures of these people, you know, Mary, Peter, Joseph, Abraham. Other people think the Bible is a book of heroes showing you people you should copy. The Bible does have some heroes in it, but as you'll soon find out, most of the people in the Bible aren't heroes at all. They make some big mistakes, sometimes on purpose. They get afraid and run away, and at times they're downright mean. No, the Bible isn't a book of rules or a book of heroes. The Bible is most of all a story. It's an adventure story of a young hero who comes from a far country to win back his lost treasure. It's a love story about a brave prince who leaves his palace, his throne, everything to rescue the one he loves. It's like the most wonderful fairy tales that has come true in real life. You see, the best thing about this story is it's true. There are lots of stories in the Bible, but all the stories are telling one big story. The story of how God loves his children and comes to rescue them. It takes the whole Bible to tell this story. And at the center of the story is a baby. Every story in the Bible whispers his name. He is like the missing piece in a puzzle, the piece that makes all the other pieces fit together. And suddenly you can see the beautiful picture. And this is no ordinary baby. This is the child upon whom everything would depend. This is the child who would one day, but wait. Our story starts right where all good stories start, right at the very beginning. Good story. And this, what you're going to learn this morning in Sunday school, and you continue to work, to learn every week, is all about Jesus, all right? Our hero. You know what a hero is, Leah?
Or somebody saved someone.
Somebody saved someone, that's right. So let me pray for you too, as you guys go back in the back and continue to learn about Jesus. And then guess what? We're going to stay in here, and all these people are going to do the same thing. Good to see you, Peyton. I love the hair.
Thank you.
I have a daughter that would love your hair too. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you so much for this day. Thank you for children. Thank you for adults. We are all your children because you've called us to yourself. And thank you for inviting us to be a part of your family. Help us to see you in every story we read. And we thank you, Jesus, for your love. Amen.
Amen. Brother Aaron is taking us back to the basics of the gospel we know is all about Jesus. And so that's what we're singing, all about Jesus. Oh, how I love him. Ready? There is a name I love to hear. I love to sing its worth. It sounds like music in my ear, the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. It tells me of a Savior's love who died to set me free. It tells me of his precious blood, the sinner's perfect plea. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me. It tells me what my Father hath in store for every day. And though I tread a darksome path, yield sunshine all the way. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. because he first loved me. It tells of one whose loving heart can fill my deepest woe, who in each sorrow bears a part that none can bear below. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me. We sang that four verses of that. Some of you still need to let your face know that, all right? Because you can't sing that without smiling, right? Can't sing this one either. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. There's just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like the fragrance after the rain. Jesus, 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 let all heaven and earth proclaim. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something about that name. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, oh my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you hear. May it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. I praise you, Lord. I praise you, Lord, and I lift my voice to honor you, oh my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you hear. May it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. Let's do that first verse again. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord, and I to worship you, oh my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you hear. May it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. Amen. You may be seated. I'm thankful that Aaron has taken us back to the basics to learn more of Jesus, because it allows me to sing my favorite song. If someone to put a gun to my face and say, now you gotta choose, this would be it. It used to be, I sing because I'm happy, that one. But I heard, oh gosh, names are terrible for me, but I think it's Jason Krebs sang the song. And I heard it, and ever since, I've fallen in love more and more with it. Old song, old hymn. I found this arrangement this week as I was thinking, because I knew the Lord placed it on my heart since Aaron was doing talking about Jesus. And so this one, if I have to say, you know, this would be my theme of life, it would be. Listen. I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or land. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hands than to be the king of a vast domain or be held in sin's dread sway. Than anything this world affords today. I'd rather have Jesus than men's applause. I'd rather be faithful to his dear cause. I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. I'd rather be true to his holy name than to be afford me today.
rather have you, Jesus, than
Jesus is the true and better Adam who passed the test in the garden, his garden, a much tougher garden, and whose obedience is imputed to us. Jesus is the true and better Abel, who though innocently slain has blood that cries out not for our condemnation, but for our acquittal. Jesus is the true and better Abraham who answered the call of God to leave all the comfortable and familiar and go into the void, not knowing whither he went. Jesus is the true and better Isaac, who was not just offered up by his father on the mount, but was truly sacrificed for us all, while God said to Abraham, "Now I know you love me, because you did not withhold your son, your only son, whom you love from me." Now we, at the foot of the cross, can say to God, "Now we know that you love me, because you did not withhold your son, your only son, whom you love from me." Jesus is the true and better Jacob, who wrestled and took the blow of justice we deserve, so we, like Jacob, only receive the wounds of grace that wake us up and discipline us. Jesus is the true and better Joseph, who is at the right hand of the king and forgives those who betrayed and sold him and uses his power to save them. Jesus is the true and better Moses, who stands in the gap between the people and the Lord and who mediates a new covenant. Jesus is the true and better rock of Moses, who struck with the rod of God's justice now gives us water in the desert. Jesus is the true and better Job. He's a truly innocent sufferer who then intercedes for and saves his stupid friends. Is that a type? See, that's not typology, it's an instinct. Jesus is the true and better David, whose victory becomes his people's victory, though they never lifted a stone to accomplish it themselves. Jesus is the true and better Esther, who didn't just risk losing an earthly palace, but lost the ultimate heavenly one, who didn't just risk his life, but gave his life. Who didn't just say, "If I perish, I perish," says, "When I perish, I'll perish for them, to save my people." Jesus is the true and better Jonah, who was cast out into the storm so we could be brought in. He's the real Passover lamb. He's the true temple, the true prophet, the true priest, the true king, the true sacrifice, the true lamb, the true light, the true bread. The Bible's not about you.
Yeah, all roads lead that direction. So, recapping last week a little bit, we'll get the hang of this in a moment. So last week we talked about the gospel part one, and I just want to bring some clarification in what we're doing as we're Christians. If you've made a decision when you're a kid to follow Christ, or maybe later in life, there's a process in your life called sanctification. That's a biblical term. Some of these big three-syllable words, sanctification, no, that's a five-syllable word, have simple meanings. That's the words they use to get this whole concept in your mind. And sanctification is that process of continually God working, separating you from his things and leading you towards him. So we're not doing things, last week we talked about, we're not achieving to receive, meaning we don't have, like most belief systems, if not all belief systems in the world, are trying to appease God so he doesn't stomp you down. But Christ, the whole purpose of the gospel is Christ came to us in our moment of need when we couldn't achieve and reach for him. The Bible calls us dead in our trespasses, that he came after us. That is the exception, the distinction about Christianity. The good news is that God, the God, the King of Kings, came after you. No other belief system holds that. You'll find as you study the scriptures and study Christianity that there's all these things that are so unnatural to our human instinct. Because we work for everything. We work for everything. Everything you do in life, think about that. Everything you do in life, you go from the time you're born, you got to earn things, right? You're getting graded in school. Money, jobs, you have to do your time to get things. So grace is foreign to us. The idea that a king would come after us. every other belief system, religions, even secularism. Think about those that don't believe in God at all. They are working to measure up in this world. And Christ comes to us and says, you can't, you don't have to, I'm coming after you. Thus, that's the freedom that we're given to live and pursue Him. That's why it's all about Jesus. We need Him desperately. We need Him desperately. And last week we talked about the dichotomy of life over here, death over here, and from the beginning it's always been that. And every decision we make in life is leading us, even just in the smallest of ways, if we think a decision out, it's leading us either towards the path of life, towards the path of death, for all people, for all people. And the good news of the gospel is when our eyes are open, we see things in a better way. Our perspective has changed towards what really matters in life. I had this conversation a few weeks ago with a friend. And one of the most humbling things I learned, now hear that, I learned as a dad that I've had to do, probably don't do enough for my kids that are hearing this sermon, is when I lose it, blow it, the flesh comes out of Aaron Yates as a dad with my kids and I blow my temper. Have any of you ever done that in here? Have your children ever led you down that path? Okay. When I've lost my temper, this had to be taught to me because this is not natural. This is gospel stuff. To go to my children and say, will you please forgive me? That was new to me. I didn't know that was in parenting 101. But that's godly Jesus parenting 101. To go to my kids and say, I blew it. I'm sorry. Will you forgive me? And not go, oh, but I was justified. No. Your dad's a sinner. Do you understand that? Your dad's broken. Will you forgive me? That's the stuff that we will never evolve to. That kind of stuff. The love your neighbor as yourself is not the natural inclination for human beings. It's what we're learning in Sunday school, talking about this morning, the depravity, the sin, the selfishness that's in us that we continually fight. That stuff, it had to be given by God to say, this is how you live. This is how you do good parenting. I'm not going to think that one up on my own. I don't think anybody will, right? It's unnatural to us, right? This is the stuff that God is leading us to. Once we walk in that light of life that we talked about last week, then we're on the trajectory towards Jesus. And that's the kind of stuff that we don't come up with on our own, right? We'll unpack that a little bit more this morning. That is a big word, sanctification, but it's essentially heart examination. Now, I'm aiming these sermons knowing that most of us have been in church for a long time, okay? I know the crowd we're talking to, and maybe some of you don't know Jesus, and it's going to apply to you too. But oftentimes, in walking with Jesus a long time, sorry, people on video, if I'm getting out of the camera, I walk around a little bit. Dad used to stand on the edge of a stage, and we'd all nervously, like he had the stage with like a 6-foot drop when I was growing up, and he'd sit there and rock, and we're like, he's going to fall one day. And we'd sit and watch him. You remember that, Mom? He never did, thank you. Good, but yeah, so I guess that's in my DNA to move a little bit. Where was I? I'm talking about, what's that? Yeah, dad falling, right before that, sanctification, yeah. Examining the heart. So what happens a lot of times once we follow Jesus, we feel secure in that, and sometimes we can get too secure, and if we go on into Romans, we're going to be in Romans 5 today. Okay, we go to the next chapters. Paul's going to talk about how we can abuse that security we have. All right, but today we're going to be in 5. But ultimately, sanctification is that heart examination things. You know what we tend to do, though, because of our inclination to work for things, to earn things. We had that before salvation. We follow Jesus. He saves us. We're secure in Him. We tend to want to go back to that checking off things. Like, okay, big ones. If you're going to be a Christian, clean mouth, check. Don't do it with substances that will destroy your life. Check. You make 3 or 4, treat my wife nicely. Check. Whatever it might be. Do good in my job. Check. We make these lists of rules, and we just kind of get those rules idolized in our lives, and we check the boxes. And I find that it is a lot easier, safer, to check a rule box off than it is to examine my heart. Think about that for a moment. Because we can check the boxes and be like, we're good, and we're forgetting all this other stuff that creeps in our lives. It's a lot more painful to examine our hearts. And then we forget about the things that aren't on the checklist. So that's what sanctification is calling us to do when we walk with Jesus. It's what continually reading this book will do to you. Like a good doctor diagnosing things, we begin to look inward and we see things creeping up inside of us that we gotta, like we talked about last week, kind of blow those flames away and pursue Jesus. We can conveniently begin to not recognize things. Because behaviors, ultimately, things we do are a result of what? The heart. The Bible says the mouth is a wellspring. The mouth is a wellspring of the heart. So those words that sometimes shock you that you just said to your wife or to your children, like, where did that come from? Right? So this is painful stuff, right? But man, I need this. I need this. I need this to be a better me, not just for me, but for my family, for the people around me, ultimately for my King that I'm trying to live for, to be light in darkness. So let's do this morning. So you don't have to stand yet. We're going to be in Romans chapter 5, and we'll read in just a minute. So we had God's design, back to the basics last week. God made us. It was good. God has a design for marriage, for friendships, for handling money, for jobs, for everything in life. God made that. And here's the cool thing, too. This morning in Sunday school, we're talking about the law. When God made things, when he gave his people the law, watch this, he said this. And it's pretty neat because I've been studying this stuff. You guys are studying this stuff with not even knowing the two would parallel. But God said when he made the law, watch this. He said, I am the Lord your God. Do you realize with the law, sometimes we see that as just a whipping post in a sense. Kind of like God is being hard on us. But when he made the law, he didn't have to. Think about this. He didn't have to make the law. He could have just made, could God not just have made you do what he wants you to do? I want you to think about that. Let your mind mull over that a little bit. Could God not just have made people do what he wants them to do? He made them. He's God, right? But he said, this is good. This is how we should do it. So he said, I am the Lord, your God. And I want to put that in perspective of thinking of the relationship we have with, say, father, mother. Your God, that's intimacy. So he said to his people, here are these list of commandments I'm giving you, provisions, principles to live by. I am your God. Like my dad saying, I am your dad. Look both ways before you cross the road, right? Because I don't want to see you harmed. That's relational. That's intimacy. That's for their own flourishment, for their own protection. And then we sinned. God gave us this design. We sinned. And then sin leads to the path, recapping last week, destruction. Here in life, we see destructive things resulting in going our own way, trying to do things our own way, going against God's design. And ultimately, God turns us over to ourselves. Take God out of it. All that is good, all that is right, that is essentially hell. That is your kingdom, a fallible kingdom. We see that here and we see that afterlife. Sin leads to our brokenness that affects everything. Do we see brokenness in our world? I'm amazed as a dad, as I teach things to my children, they discover you protect them for a while when they're young. Everything's rosy and beautiful, right? Then as they see things in the news and you have to explain things to them. And I remember explaining some things to my children they were unaware of and seeing tears roll down their face as they learned the depravity and the sinfulness of humanity. Brokenness. It's everywhere, right? It's in our own lives. It affects everything. Romans says they exchanged the truth of God, design, for a lie and worshiped the Creator rather than the created instead of the Creator. Basically, they worship stuff instead of the one who made the stuff. Get that? Let's read together. Romans 5, verse 12. We're standing. I don't even have to tell you guys. All right, and this is great. So last week we were in the first part of 5. Here we're going to get to this. You're going to see some brilliant writing here in Paul. The philosopher Paul setting up this dichotomy of over here, like I did last week with life and death. You're going to see Jesus versus Adam. Jesus versus Adam. Watch this as we read, okay? And this is more in the next section that we'll read in just a moment. Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, so he's taking him back to Genesis, and death reigned, death through sin, in this way death spread to all men, because all sinned. In fact, sin was in the world before the law, but sin is not charged to a person's account when there is no law. Now, he's not saying there was no sinning before the law. He was saying men were already guilty. They were already heading towards the path of death. That the law just exposed those details, essentially. Okay? Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses. Death still reigned. That's what he's saying right there. Even over those who did not sin in the likeness of Adam's transgression. He, Adam, is a prototype of the coming one. Okay? You may be seated. I'm going to read again, but I'm going to read a lot of passages today. So I'll let y'all sit down. So the law exposed the guilt that was already there. Okay? Interesting fact, and I mentioned this in our prayer group this morning. America had godly men speaking into it when it was designed. You know why we have a checks and balance system in America? You know why we have all these groups trying to keep men in check in the name of democracy? Because these Christians had an idea of man's big theological term, depravity, their sinfulness, their selfishness. And there were godly men that were speaking into this at our foundation, knowing we need a checks and balance system because we're sinful, we're prideful, we like power. We knew that. And the gospel is the good news that comes like an arrow into our depravity and leads us to life. The gospel is the proclamation that God did not leave us in that brokenness. There's an answer for our brokenness. And as you can see right now, we're never going to solve that trying to figure it out on our own. We can just look around us. Can we not just read history? Not just now, but throughout time. I mean, the Bible is really, there's more in there on what not to do in some sense. Just seeing how man has folly after folly after folly going their own way. Romans 5:15. I'm going to pick up here. But the gift is not like the trespass. And you're going to see Adam and Jesus. For if by one man's trespass many died, how much more has the grace of God and the gift overflowed to the many by the grace of one man, Jesus Christ. So he says, you're not stuck in this. This is the good news. And the gift is not like the one man's sin, because from one sin came judgment, resulting in condemnation, the separation from God. God cannot mix with sin. He is holy. He is pure. He doesn't mix with it. It doesn't go with who he is. It's not an attribute of God. But from many trespasses came the gift, resulting in justification. Since by one man's trespass death reigned through the one man, how much more will those who receive the overflow of grace and the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ? The scripture is referring to Jesus being the second Adam. He is the 2.0, the perfect version that will not fall and did not fall into folly and selfishness. Can y'all pull me down in the monitors, please? Jesus is the reboot, our reboot to lead us towards life. And the scripture says we repent and believe to follow him. We turn from our way. Remember, death, life. I think I keep switching these. I think it was death over here, life over here. If we are pursuing our own way, repentance means what? Repentance was a military term that meant to turn 180 and go the opposite direction towards life. A 180 opposite direction towards life. And put total trust in God to recover and pursue God's design. Okay? So we have God's design, brokenness. The gospel is the good news leading us back towards God's design. We are reconciled back to God and to God's design. Philippians 2:13 says, "For God is working in you, giving you the desire and the power to do what pleases him." Now let's camp out on that, and we're going to wrap it up, hang here for most of the time. So back to the fall, we follow Jesus. Here you go. For God is working in you, giving you the desire and the power to do what pleases him. Who does it? Who gives you the want to? God. Right? So we're not just, we get saved, we follow Jesus, we make a decision to follow Jesus, and God stands back going, good job, Randy, go get him. It says he is relational, he is in you. In fact, the Bible says he gives us the Holy Spirit reigning and residing in us to lead us towards life. This is when things get cloudy in your life and you can't see anything but darkness, and there's an inner voice, a wooing, saying, I've got you there. You're going to make it. I remember gloom and doom in my life in the past few years of some of the situations we've walked through in that valley of the shadow of death when there is no light. And sometimes you think when you're young and you hear about the valley of the shadow of death, like that's a quick journey. You know, shadows don't last long. Sometimes you pinch your tit that pit. You pitch your tent there. That's a YouTube video. It just subconsciously got me. You're there longer than you want to be. You don't intend to stay, but you're there for a long time. And there's this inner stillness of peace holding you, saying you're anchored in spite of the storm. This is Philippians 2:13. For God is working in you, giving you the desire and the power to do what pleases him. He gives you the want to. He keeps giving you the want to try. That God works in you. Jesus is the gospel. He is the life that shows us life, death, and new life through his resurrection. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away, and look, new things have come. Everything is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. He gave us over to you to be his hands and feet to this broken, dark world. This is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and he committed the message of reconciliation to us. He left it with you. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, certain that God is appealing through us. We plead on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. He made the one who did not sin to be sin for us so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. God is leading us to lead others to this path of life, recognizing what we were once in and pulling them and pointing them away to life, that there is a way, there is a better way. This is the good news. This is great news. And the most familiar scripture of all, you probably grew up, if you grew up in the church, memorizing John 3:16. For God so loved the world, help me with it, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal, everlasting life. The last verse that we tend not to know as well. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. God didn't come to condemn us, but to lead us to life, to life, to the road of life, to not leave us in our brokenness. But man, how we love to be our own kings. Man, how we love to try to rule. Man, how we love to try to figure it out and go our own way. This is human nature. This is all the stuff we've been talking about this morning, Sunday school. Each week we're talking about the selfishness, the depravity, the want to be our own king. Can we not learn, looking at history, looking at the brokenness of our world, looking at just opening our eyes, turning on the news, we can't figure it out. How long is it going to take? And God's saying, I'm right here. Open your eyes. The gospel sets everything right. Christianity is the exception to all these systems of belief. Religion says, religion's man going after God, that I perform, therefore I'm accepted. And I want you to hear this, because this is the stuff that's really foreign to us and doesn't make sense. And this is why some people have a real problem with Christianity, because they go, I got to do this, right? I got to do this. It's me. All belief systems say perform, therefore accepted. Christianity says accepted, therefore perform. You hear that? Because these little nuggets of truth are going to take some mulling over for a minute. Every system of belief, everyone, Islam, pantheism, secularism, it's all about me and making my place in the world and getting my identity. Islam's all about works and the law and obeying Allah so he doesn't crush you. Pantheism's all about balance and you doing your part to get good karma and come back. All of them, work, 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 work. Christ says, I'm going to do it in your place. Where Adam blew it, where mankind went their own way, I'm coming after you. That's the prodigal God, man. If you look at the prodigal son, and we'll get there eventually, he comes running after us. Running after us, pursuing him. So all belief system says perform for acceptance. Christianity says you're accepted, therefore live. Life, therefore perform. Gives you the want to be like Christ, the perfect human, the perfect father, the perfect dad, the perfect friend, the perfect human being to look at and go, I want to be like that. Our identity is not in things fleeting, but in the King. All systems say this, follow rules to get a stable sense of self. Think about that. Follow rules to get a stable sense of self. That's what our culture's teaching. Follow rules. If you just do this, you find stability, right? If you just find your mark, make your mark in the world, there's stability there. If you'll just do this in your marriage, if you'll just do this as a parent, if you'll just get this education, stability. And then you look at belief systems, same thing. If you just follow these rules, if you get this much money, same thing. Christianity says just the opposite. You get a stable sense of self, then you follow rules. Hear that? Just the opposite. Totally opposite. It's the exception. Do you see that? It's distinctive. This is not human wisdom. No one can make this stuff up. And we see this over and over from this thick book, from the beginning to the end. It's there. And lastly, Christianity says this. Because you are a child of the King, I want you to see this. You can be, you know how people are seeking balance in life? Only God brings that balance. That's robbed from Scripture. As you see, the Scripture constantly reminds us to keep things in check. Check. Don't get too far over on this way. The creation, don't get too far into the creation and worshiping that. Keep in check. Keep in perspective. The whole balance thing, that was robbed from God. Watch this. Christianity is the only system of belief. It says we can be humble to the dust, yet at the same time affirm to the sky. I want you to think about that. I know it's early. Humbled to the dust because God did it all. There's nothing we can say to go, look at me, I did it. Keeps us humble, but you're affirmed to the sky because of whose you are. You get that? I'm a child of the King. Better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Humbled, yet at the same time affirmed. That's what everyone's looking for in life. You see that? Only Christ can strike that balance in your life. This is what the world needs to hear. Some of you got that already. This is what your world needs to hear. They're looking for something to give them value. They're looking for something. You hear that word over and over today, identity. And it's only found in knowing whose you are, because there's rest in that. Knowing I belong to the King. I'm His. And He has a greater perspective on all this than I can ever imagine. In fact, He made me and knows how I work. And all these things our human race is struggling to figure out, He knew already. He knows already. And you see over and over again in our culture, I watched this in teaching teenagers for 20 years, them just looking for some new fight to fight then to give them meaning and purpose in their life. What we're fighting right now in our culture, what generations are arming themselves to, and some things are good, but they're trying to find their whole value in those things they're fighting for. Even in trying to help other people. If that ends there, it ends there. That's it. That's it. There's no complete identity in that. Only identity, only true identity comes from knowing we are a child, a masterpiece of our Creator, made in His image. We're His. And then rest in that. And then out of that, we live knowing we can give all. That is good. We can love people well, and He's going to continue to fill our tank so we can do that well. We are firm to the sky, at the same time humbled to the dust, because God came after us. I hope you can rest in that this morning. Knowing that you are His. And because you are His, we want to be like Him. We want to look to Him. When I'm going to get into this next week, and I'm ending with this. When you're a dad, when you have kids, you have to teach them things at young ages so they don't harm themselves, right? Such as, do not cross the road without looking both ways. You heard me refer to that one. There's a number of ones we can go to. I think of right now, Silas's thing is finger in light plug. Okay? So Silas has a small capacity of a brain. He's a smart kid, but he just thinks his little finger will fit in that plug perfectly. So he's always run into the plug. I tell Silas, no, I reprimand him. And sometimes you got to get hard on kids when you're trying to teach them things. His little brain, all he sees is the plug. My finger fits. Ooh, looks like fun. My perspective as his father is different. I see that that can lead to harm. It can hurt him. And there's things his little brain's going to do, seeing things across the road he's going to want to run to. And I, as a dad, I'm saying, no! And in that moment, Silas might get angry and upset with me. Like, how dare dad do this? Dad can't. Does he even love me? He might ask himself that. Because I'm stopping his little brain from getting what he wants. But I love that kid so much, I'm going to watch out for his best interest, even if he gets mad at me. I'm going to give him some things and say, you got to live this way to preserve your life, even when he can't see it. His brain sees what's across the road. His brain sees that light socket. That's it. Just got the blinders on, right? I see everything around. I know what cars can do to children, right? So I've got to teach and instill, even if he gets mad at me. And then the hope as his dad, and for each of my children, is this, that one day he'll learn dad has my best interest in mind. And he'll begin to love me, not as just a rule follower. I don't want that for my children. I don't want them to just be checking the boxes saying, yeah, I made dad happy today. No. I want them to follow and obey me because they know I love them and they honor me and they trust me. I want kids to obey out of honor, out of love, and knowing Dad has the best in mind for me. Because you know what? I am their dad. I'm their dad. This is what God has done for us. He says, I love you. You might not see it. This one might hurt a little bit. I might have to spank your behind, right? But I see all these things flying around you that will hurt you, that will harm you. Pursue this direction. Stay the course. This stuff will take you down, even if you feel like it won't, even if you, I want it so bad. God's saying, I see it all. I see what's coming. I see what's over here. I see a different perspective than you do. I love you. I am the Lord, your God. Trust me. Trust me. He loves you. He loves you. He loves them. He loves this world that is trying to make themselves king. He's saying, I'm still here and I'll come after you. Will you be that voice north side of good news to those who need it? So let's just pray this morning and commit that. Maybe you've been checking the boxes for a long time and you have lost that intimacy with God. He is the Lord, your God. And maybe you need to just shake everything off and run to him this morning. Spend some time with him. Now is your opportunity. Hey, if you ever need to talk to me, I know even the invitation is kind of weird with Corona. If you want to pray with me, I'm here on a weekly basis to meet with you. I'm around. Connect with me. Connect with some of these other godly men or ladies that you know. You need to say, I just need to talk about my relationship with God. I'm not doing so well. That's what we're here for, guys. We're in the trenches together, okay? So we're going to have a time of prayer and commitment. Let's just think about that as what has God said to you this morning that you can go out of here and apply to your life. Let's pray together. And as Randy comes up, he's going to lead us in a song. Father, we thank you so much for your love. Thank you for your call to us that you are our God. We are your people and you love us. God, help us to trust you, to love you out of honor, to know you have our best interests. The scripture says to prosper, not to harm us, to lead us to hope and future in you. And may we rest on that this morning. And thank you for the call to know you. Thank you for coming after us when we were dead in our sins, in our trespasses. God, if we're stale right now, I pray we just seek you, to call on you. If we don't know you, maybe we've never made you king of our life. We do, as the scripture says, call on the name of the Lord and we'll be saved. We'll know you. And we can live life wanting to be like Jesus, the perfect man, the redeemed, the right. Thank you, Jesus. In your name, amen.
Let's stand together.
Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Thou art the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will. While I am waiting, yielded and still. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Search me and try me, Master, today. Whiter than snow, Lord, wash me just now. As in thy presence, humbly I bow.
All right, well, thank you for being here. Good day today. Good day to be together. It's always a good thing. So I'm gonna read that passage again in Numbers, if I can locate it. I lost my place. Let's see if I have it right here. You know what? Let's do this. Let's just pray together, okay? And then I'm going to, it's going to take a while to find it. All right? Go knowing that he loves you this morning. Go knowing that he is the Lord, your God. And he has your best in mind. And remember that as we see people in this city. Ask, how can we love them well and lead them to the life that God has called us to? Let's pray together, and Randy's going to sing us out with one more song. God, we thank you so much for your love for us. May we go in your name, knowing that your face is shining upon us, and we are armed with the good news of the gospel. May they know the good King, Jesus. May we live that. May we proclaim that in our marriages, in our families, in our jobs, in our workplace, at school, sharing the good news with others, knowing that you lead them and give them life to the fullest. We pray this in your holy name, Jesus. Amen.
Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me.
Amen.